at any point when we're at this meeting, we always go, yep, we need to finish this, we're 10 minutes done, we've got an hour left.
Is this for all meetings or workshop or?
All meetings.
So.
We've always been able to extend it.
Yes.
And it just helps avoid rambling.
Well, and it's a little bit easier for everyone to know, basically, this is the meeting here. I've looked at this, and there may be something that might go longer, but I have a rough idea that this is when it's going to end versus the meetings that used to end at midnight or 12:30.
Well, that's true, because for people's planning, yeah.
Absolutely. And because it's worked so well, my position is let's just leave the 3 hours and can be extended by a vote.
Right.
And so I think it's been working well.
That would be the thing, yes. If you kept the 3 hours, we would have to then vote to extend.
Yeah.
If we remove that, then.
And taking the actual time out is good, because then whenever you change something, you don't have to come back to this. It's good for everybody forever.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah,
if we change the times of the meetings, it doesn't
keep
affect
changing,
that.
So,
then is it fair to say the consensus of the board is to leave not to exceed 3 hours?
Yep.
Put that as an action item on the next
meeting. Well, I don't like it. I don't like being handcuffed for the discussions that we just had before about.
Well, we extend it by vote, and we always do.
I know, but I think that setting the time frame, I just don't like that. I like the fact if we have business to finish or conduct, I mean, to disrupt it, to say that we have to extend it, I mean, and I get it, the past is the past. I mean, we have to be able to move forward, and I just don't like being handcuffed, that's me. I don't like being saying that we have to meet and leave in 3 hours.
But we don't.
We have business. But some members, board members do, and it's happened before, to say that I've got to go, so we have to wrap this up, and I don't like that.
But they may have to go anyway, whether we're open.
I know, and then they should members have to leave, they have to leave.
Right.
So, I mean, I think that we shouldn't be straddled with that, that's all.
I think Carrie mentioned it earlier that if you set a standard, then that's something that you work around and that starts it. But I strongly feel, and I support Jeff, that the work of the board needs to be done. We're here to serve the district. That when we're elected, and I appreciate what Terry said as far as work and personal schedules of each board member, but that when we run for this position, we say that we're here to do that work.
Right.
And I really I didn't like the idea of time limits in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
But Amy's point was, and part of the focus, and this board is somewhat different, and that's why, that we've said, we're trying to focus our work. And if you have a structure, so I'm speaking both sides of this. If you have something said, this is our goal, then it doesn't run on and on and on and on and on.
Mm-hmm.
So it to me it's I never liked the idea of a on the board meeting.
Okay.
That's just my I just don't think that's a board member. That's not what we should be doing.
What about you, Sharon?
I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm.
Well, I'm just saying is that like Eric kind of described too is that if we have business to conduct here, I mean I like the way the committee of the whole is working and we're working on it to where we have a massive amount of discussion now and then take the action on the meetings, but. I think that if the administration or even if the board has issues, to say that we can't fit it in, we have to stick to a half hour of presentations, but yet the superintendent or the board has something they want to discuss, I mean, I just think that, again, it handcuffs us. So it should be an open sort of forum to make sure that we get the business done for the next meeting, in the meeting. So I like the no 3 hour thing.
I agree with both the gentlemen. I do like the fact that I think that the work of the board needs to be done regardless of time, but I do also see the aspect of having a goal. And you're right, Sharon, in the fact that we always vote to extend, and when we vote to extend, we do what we need to do.
Right.
So I guess I would just say, which one do we want to see? Which wording do we want to see up? And then we can continue this conversation in the second meeting of the month and actually take the vote.
Eric, do you have a preference?
Which do we want to see?
If you want to think about it more and move on, we could prep both of them and then have more conversations through the next week.
I know, that's why we had such a hard time at committee. We were like,
and we just elected Amy as president.
Yeah.
And she sets the agenda.
Yeah.
I really think, and she does have a skill for conducting meetings.
Yeah.
I mean, and that part of it, and being finite.
Yeah.
And so I think much what Amy's opinion is on this or how to conduct the meeting, I think is critical.
I like define goals. But, and I have sat in meetings and said, look, it's 8 o'clock and we've got a lot left to go here.
Mm-hmm.
We got to pick up the pace. And it brings people back into focus. Or we've got another half hour or and I said at 8:30, we're not gonna be able to finish, we need a motion to extend the meeting. And.
Then let's roll with that.
And everybody does.
Let's just make a decision and roll with it.
Okay, well, we can talk about, we can vote today on it, or we can extend it to the fourth meeting.
I think just vote.
Okay.
Okay. I need a motion.
Wait.
Which are we voting on?
Yeah.
I didn't think we were voting on policy here.
It's board operating procedure, which it's kinda splitting hairs, but it's board operating procedure.
Good point.
Well, we don't have to vote then. We, you can wait till the policy committee has.
We're still in a special meeting, we're not in the first meeting of the month yet.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's big.
But we can take that and.
I think technically we have to though, in order to set the times for the meetings going forward.
We're setting the time, yeah.
Because the way the operating procedure says 6:30.
Because we have to change the policy.
Yep.
Right.
So the,
So move.
Yeah.
To what though, we haven't clarified.
To the timeframe.
Yeah.
So move to the timeframe.
To the meetings, meeting time, yep, option A, there you go.
Not to exceed 3 hours.
An organizational meeting, but not to exceed 3 hours, second.
I did. I already did.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
I'm a no.
Okay. And that's fine.
You're allowed, Jeff, you're allowed.
Okay, the next item is the committee survey. I asked Nikki to put a little description of what they are, because they've always fascinated me. I look at some of these titles and, oh, I don't know what that means. So please, if you're interested, fill it out and get it back to me before the end of the week.
Okay.
Do
you want it in your mailbox or email?
Email, please, and call me.
No, I already got it.
Oh, you already got it, if you got it done. Great, if you can do it today.
Wait, did I miss something?
There's two pages.
How many pages do you have? I just got a front and a back.
I did.
Name on the back, sorry.
Yeah, sorry, please.
If you don't put your name on it, it was never done.
And you get no credit.
We don't really know who's going on which committee then.
Well, I think you want that, sorry, thank you.
Okay, thank you. And if you don't have it with you, we can get some copies for you. Okay, next item is.
God, this is.
And legion of signature others, are we in, these are authorization signatures by the board.
This is a voting item.
It's a voting item. What do we have to vote on?
Someone.
Second motion to recommend approval for the January 22nd, 2008, yeah.
Okay, I just wanna put this out here, don't you guys do this in the next meeting, okay?
Yeah, I see, but pretty much it's the officers.
Yep, same old, yep.
Support. So it's within it, according to board policy.
Jeffrey supported it.
Yep, we got Mary and Jeff, we're good.
We're ready to vote.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, and we have to fill that out for Nikki, and authorization signatures for checks.
Well, the nice thing is you don't have to change anything, right?
It's everyone, for the same.
Same.
Support.
Mary Hillary, okay, we're good.
Okay.
We get a vote.
And Michigan, okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Michigan Association of School Board Voting Delegates, again, it's the.
Wait, three. You're delegating the posting of the board meetings to Nikki.
Get to Nikki.
Oh.
It's way at the top.
Support.
We're ready to vote.
All those in favor?
Dudes, I can't write that fast anymore.
Just say, we voted yes all the way.
I just got, oh, yes, that's it.
Okay, delegates to vote, be the voting and alternates, and again, this is the board members and the trustees are the alternates.
Yep.
So move.
Any second? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And.
So move.
We're gonna move you out of the room.
I need a motion to adjourn this meeting.
So move.
All those in favor?
Aye.
That goes for me.
Yep, gotta get done.
There we go.
But I just don't think you'll hold on to the meeting.
See what happens when we leave.
I have an agenda later, I forget what was on there.
Before we start, I have an addendum to the meeting today, for this meeting.
Hey-oh.
We're gonna do a closed session, a real short closed session, and it's been requested by HR. So.
And we're doing that what?
I don't know.
I suppose, sure.
Can we call the order?
Right.
We'll change the agenda.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, let's call the meeting in order.
Yes, it is.
Is it recording?
Yes, it is.
8:48. We're calling the meeting in order. Stand for the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I make a motion that we approve the agenda with a closed session added to it.
Support.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And just to put it on the record, it's for an employee matter, with the exception of an employee matter.
Okay, and where do we wanna stick it?
All I can say is I'm glad we're not in, is it Clarkson chief?
Yes.
Oh.
Yes.
Yeah, no, no fears, it's not like that.
Push pause.
Oh, yeah, push pause.
Do we wanna add it to eight, just make it H2 under Human Resources Office?
H2.
H2, okay. Does that work for you?
We can't do that, it has to be a closed session.
Closed session.
Right.
Oh, a closed session.
But where's it gonna go on the agenda?
At the end.
Right.
You can do it at H2 and then everyone else could leave, because I is just us.
It's just, yeah.
Okay, so we'll do H2.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, that makes sense.
All right. Roll call. Presentations.
Roll call? We don't have to.
Oh, yeah, roll call.
Roll call.
I forgot, we're all here, but.
Gotta do it officially.
I know, you can just mark them all in.
Here.
Mrs. Trevette.
Here.
Mrs. Hilton.
Yes.
Mr. Hubler.
Here.
Mr. Pegg.
Present.
Mrs. Ross, yes. Mrs. Serviceal.
Yes.
And Dr. Spencer.
Here.
And nobody left.
All here and no one escaped, yes.
Okay. We'll begin with the presentations.
First thing, yes.
I'll introduce really quickly and just, we're gonna make some change to, before everyone got here, we're gonna make some changes to, not to the way the paper meeting looks, but to the committee of the whole, which we'll discuss after the meeting. I just wanted to say that came out of the first meeting. So this perhaps would be something that would occur below the line in the future, not to say it wouldn't be considered an update or a presentation, but just so everyone is aware of that. And I don't think it impacts the schedule we developed, but the board will receive that today. Okay, so this was something that, this should be brief, but please feel free to ask questions as to why or how this occurs. This is a timeline for two pieces, teacher timeline for staffing. Some of it is directed by contract, some of it is directed by us to get things done in a timely fashion. And then there's an administrative timeline as well for, to review administrative procedures in order to make sure we're staffed for the school year next year, and basically it starts very soon. So, Mike, please.
I do have paper copies of what's on the computer, if you prefer a paper copy to look at. Just give the look and we can send those around.
I'll take one, please.
Here, we'll just grab one if you want. Anyone on this side need something in paper? So what you're looking at is, as Eric mentioned, is documents we publish, and they'll be published soon, both to teachers and to our administrative staff regarding the staffing timelines set for the year. Quite frankly, it's the same document we used last year, and we updated the dates. Nothing is really different from it. My hope is that you probably haven't seen this before, and I want you to get a sense that it is a collaborative process. It's collaborative between HR and the curriculum office and the buildings, and it's collaborative with our teacher group. And we go in with sets of numbers, so we'll be pulling up, you know, as we roll over numbers and grades at the K-5 level, at the middle school level, and you start to get an idea of what you need, both for gen ed and for special ed. You start coming up with staffing levels that you may need by grade, by subject matter, you know, whatever it may be at the different levels. And we want it to be collaborative, so people have the opportunity to ask the tough questions. We'd rather have them ask the questions and find something out before it becomes official later on. But you can see the timelines in here as far as retirements, as far as people wanting leaves, taking new leaves or returning from current leaves, so we can make sure to account for them or not account for them in the process. I'm trying to think of where else to go with this right now. Well, maybe just open it up to pick it apart or ask questions.
The bold in, is there a reason why in April 23rd to the 27th there's two bold bullet points versus the regular font? I mean, is there a reason for that? Is there though something new?
Well, here's the thing. That's a great question. They changed the rules or the law, let's say. Teachers used to have more rights, right? Isn't that a really simplistic statement as far as things they could ask for, what seniority might mean regarding teacher placement in general? The district now has total right of placement. However, as a district, we're still asking our teachers, what would you prefer? And we still get, and it gets confusing. Are you using preference sheets? Are you not using preference sheets or forms? And the answer is yes. We still want to know, if possible, we would like people teaching what they're qualified for, right, which we don't have a choice about, but also what they would like to teach. So that's what that's about.
And I'm sorry, so do you have, let's just say, openings every year?
Like, we will.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then so you kind of put it out like a transfer list to whereas they, if they see an opening that they like and they have seniority, then there's a chance that they would get that, but like you just described, there's also the chance that they won't because we have that right.
So you kind of have two things going on at once. On the administrative side, we'll be sending out to buildings, this is about how many staff or FTE, right? You have 30 teachers to work with. You're going to have 20 teachers. You're going to have 80 teachers, whatever the building. And they start to come up with a plan based on the scheduling and the numbers. This is the teachers I have. This is what I need them to be doing. On the other hand, you have the teachers saying, this is maybe what I want to do. Hopefully, they're also communicating with one another.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Who's determining the FTEs?
In practice, the curriculum office and the HR department.
In actual. Like, actually, who's determining
the staffing FTEs?
Mm-hmm.
We are, the HR office.
Not curriculum.
We sit together, but in reality, it's me meeting with those building principals and handing them a sheet that lists how many staff FTEs they will have.
But you do a collaborative with curriculum. Mm-hmm. I mean, you were looking, it's a business, and we have to look at costs and student
Correct.
Numbers.
But we have to look at needs.
And needs of the building, but also you're working with curriculum on what they have going on, or plans.
Yes, I mean, particularly at the K-5 level. I mean,
what I want to know is that it's a very collaborative process, because I'm sure everybody's aware that in the past it has just been a number handed down without any regard for education.
So when the number is determined, but then the meeting will be with the building administrator for the building administrator to have a collaborative conversation with them. And it's not uncommon for the principal to say, this makes me nervous, or I'm on the edge of science teachers, I really need another half science teacher, and then it goes back and forth, and it is very collaborative. So that's why giving it enough time allows for some play to occur to see if certain things pan out. So for example, we're hearing that a lot of kids, or we've got sign-up sheets that a lot of kids have signed up for this class more than in the past, let's say. So therefore, we think we need an extra half FTE for this. Okay, well, let's see if that really happens. Yes, it really does happen. See another half FTE, or et cetera, et cetera. So this plays out beyond that initial, here's your number. Yes.
And hopefully, if you were to talk to building administrators, they would back up this comment, I've been very clear with them. Their job is to advocate for their building and their staff and their students. So I would expect them to come back with, right, wanting to bargain or negotiate or stick up for their school and That's how we're going to get the best decisions made. In the end, there's still this many students in a building, and just because you have more kids sign up for one class, maybe you had just, you know, the same percentage decrease in another, right? So how are you going to balance that? How are you going to meet that schedule? So it's it needs to be honest back and forth, and
I agree with Mrs. Hilton about the collaborative, because even once those FTEs, you know, the requests from the buildings and the collaborative process, in the end, if decisions have to be made, Lisa and the curriculum people, there are some district priorities. So if you can't do everything, obviously there would be some directions based on what we need for the entire district that would have to have some interplay with what the buildings need as well. So we have building needs, we also have district needs, and I think what Mary was trying to get at was that there should be a collaborative process. Mm-hmm. So we make it.
And it is, it is. And, mm-hmm.
And it's constant.
You can use one.
It's a lot of back and forth.
We call that all the time.
But if we all answer to what's
really, but I understand. Mm-hmm.
No, but as long as it's, I agree, a really collaborative that building doesn't feel like it's being forced on them. Mm-hmm. And if the teachers are teaching something they like, they teach it well. If they're just stuck in a class because mm-hmm. you can teach fourth grade as well as you can teach third, but they like third graders, then they'll do a reasonably good job, but they won't have the enthusiasm that you want a teacher to walk in the classroom with.
And it's, just so everyone knows too, it's a practice that once buildings have an idea of the staff number, they are largely in control of programming their own buildings as far as who teaches what, which I expect is fairly collaborative as well. And those buildings take informal preferences from teachers as well, and in many cases to say you want to keep doing what you're doing or versus what you want to do something different. So that occurs at the building level as well. Only if there's a student teacher that transfers. The only time that this becomes less collaborative is if there is an opening and there's no interest in the first phase, and then sort of in phase two here, someone says, you know what, I don't want to teach fifth grade at Yaks anymore, I want to try middle school, and they're certified, there's a middle school opening. In that case, the principal on that singular issue may have less control over it because that person wants to, there's an opening, mm-hmm. you know, there's an opening has to be filled within someone.
Right.
Now they can still talk to the person and decide if it's a good fit or not, but other than that, the principal really does control
well,
the
still,
building staff.
Well, still, in that case, it's in the best interest
correct.
Of the district.
Right, so.
And then this is for informational purposes, our next meeting next mm-hmm. week, we won't have to approve the
it's
timeline.
Just
it's just
information. Yeah, we were talking, we didn't know what you knew or didn't know.
Yeah.
That's fine. No, that's
yeah.
fine. I just,
yeah.
that,
yeah.
It's
yeah.
better, I like knowing what.
When does our teachers
so
contract
if somebody asks
expire?
Me a question, I'm not going to.
End of,
I think some of us have
August
this information and some don't.
Right,
right.
There you go.
And do you know when will we start negotiations for that new contract?
Guessing next year?
Formally
it'll be next year. What
really
time, if it's in the beginning or,
okay.
You know.
Okay. We're not going to do it a year ahead of time and say
no.
Right.
I just don't know, like, roughly how much, what that window
well,
looks
we're
like.
Well, I do like to start earlier rather than later, but I don't want to.
Summer of 19.
Well, we're not going to promise something we can't promise.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just the way it is. But I do, I would like to start, it's a negotiation, so
yeah.
we'll see what everyone wants to do. But formally, I'd like to start in the fall. Not wait till the winter.
Thank you.
The fall of this year?
No.
Or the fall of 19?
Fall of 18.
Because
it expires at the
end
of 19.
Yeah. So
it expires
like
June
September
19.
Of 18.
Correct. You know.
Okay.
Next fall. Yeah. And by fall, we'll have some idea what 19 is going to look like?
Well, that's part of the process.
Maybe.
I mean, you may not get down to that until the spring, but it might take some time to get there.
Right. Yeah.
When's especially financing.
Election?
In the fall.
No, in the November
yes.
of this year.
So, yes,
of
I think
year.
That's. I think there may be more than one group of people wanting to wait to see what happens in November.
Yeah,
let's just put it.
Yeah. yeah.
My last thing with the staffing, and that will play a part of it, is number of retirements. I can tell you we have, you've already, I think, accepted some retirements from
mm-hmm.
teachers, and I believe there's another one or two on the employment recs going next
mm-hmm.
week. So, you know, that has a bearing on things. So we'll see.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. It's that time of year again. And item number two is schools of choice for the 18-19 school year. The reason, I want to talk for a couple seconds. The reason that this is, if you love or hate this presentation, I would love to receive comment on that. I am not really, I don't feel much for this one way or another. It does take some work to load this. It's very data rich, okay? It's very data rich. It is not a very, it's not a perception-based presentation, let's put it that way, and that may be something that people want to talk more about, I don't know. But the bottom line is, it is updated for current information, and so again, I'm not, that was not reinvented. This is my first time being in, as superintendent, dealing with this issue directly. Obviously, I've dealt with it indirectly before. So I, this is the presentation that may look familiar to you from the past, but it's just to update the data. And I will look for feedback from the board for if this is something that's presented in the future about how it could change. But this is why the first shot at it, it's just a data presentation.
Okay.
The other thing is, I know that people feel strongly about this issue. Obviously, this is not a new issue for us, and the recommendation has refined from year to year based on some requests of a board and other individuals. So you'll see at the end of this whole thing, you'll see a recommendation that's fairly similar, quite similar to what we went with this year. It is not an expansion of number of seats. It is not a wide open high school program. It's still a limited high school program, and it is a K-8 open program. We will go as fast or slow on this as you want to go. So if you feel like, yes, I don't need to see this, or no, I want to ask more questions about this, please be reflective on that, and then we'll open it up and talk about it. Okay? Is that all right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so in the free box, just so that there's not confusion, that is the recommendation that's going to be brought forward next week. I just included it on there so that you could see what the recommendation would be next week.
Mm-hmm.
I know we don't usually do that for informational purposes, but because it's so long and lengthy, and like Eric said, this is the first time he and I have done it, we wrote it out first so that everybody could see it, just to make sure that we had it. It's definitely not for today.
And that's the recommendation to be
based on today.
That can change based on conversation.
Correct.
Today too. Just go ahead.
Correct.
Yeah.
But we felt like we should write it out first so that you could see how it's went in the past.
Appreciate it. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So Eric said, these are things that you have seen before. They are updated. In terms of the whole district, I don't know how to make it bigger.
Can I guess? Yeah, so what does this have to do with school choice?
Okay,
the ethnic breakdown. Why are we even looking at this for schools of choice? This should have zero impact on schools of choice.
So that's what I was trying
because
to say.
Because that suggests that we're concerned about race with schools of choice.
That's why, I don't know how. I'll just try again. I'm just trying to present. I have had very little input from board members about what they wanted to talk about in terms of this, so I'm simply rolling over. Mary, more comments like that about what you want to see in this or don't want to see in this are very accepted. You know what I mean? So, in other words,
stands my question. What does this, the ethnic breakdown of our district, have to do with schools of choice?
I don't think it should have any impact.
Right.
Their children, they're not brown children, they're not
okay.
Green
that's fine.
Children.
That's
they're
fine.
Not,
they're not but they're not for maybe this particular discussion, but do we not, the state has this data and wants this data, so are we saying we don't ever want to see this as a board?
No,
or we want
to
see it somewhere else?
It doesn't have anything to do with schools of choice.
No, I acknowledge that.
Mm-hmm.
I acknowledge that. But
zero.
Where do we want to see this at?
Because
then?
You're making this a race issue right there.
No, I'm not, actually. When I read it, I didn't see it that way at all, but it's because I was appreciative of it. But where do we want this to be then?
But
maybe not.
I don't then know
no,
that it's,
I, want
it's
to.
I don't know that it's necessarily relevant to this. However, to Sharon's point, as a board member, I think we should have a good grasp of the demographics of our district, not just race, but all different kinds of demographics.
Then ask for that separate of schools of choice.
Exactly.
Right,
yes.
So that's
yeah.
what I'm saying. It's not in here, but
separate.
Where we want to
so
put it.
So we can
maybe
use that.
Just a demographic report at
that,
some
okay.
point.
That'd
that
be good.
Be done
yeah.
separately.
Separate
okay.
and
yeah.
yes.
Bring this.
because like Eric said, he and I just took the presentation you had last year and updated. We did remove some things that we thought, why was
this
here?
Well, it was super long.
You can't use Jackie's presentations and think they're good.
Well, and I wanted to say, I don't, and I'm not going to speculate as to slide by slide who wanted each slide in there. You know, I mean, I'm sure there's a story behind every single one of them. You know what I mean?
The demographics to me is, this is just children in the school. And we're going to educate them.
But the state breaks it down like this, so there's no reason not to have these numbers at all.
Yeah, but I think it should be.
But linking with school choice.
No, it doesn't have to be school choice at all.
Because it can be biasing.
Okay.
All right,
next slide.
Okay.
Oops,
just scroll.
So, and just a general question, is this same presentation going to be made next week?
Well, we can talk about that.
We can change it.
I'm hoping to take that one out then.
Well, right, I'm saying though, I mean, technically speaking, do we see it, do we have to put it out there again?
No. This is a board, okay, so school of choice must be approved by the Board of Education.
Must be considered.
Excuse me, must be considered for approval. I mean, in other words, administration can't just do it. That's what I was trying to say, Mary. We just can't say, let's do it. Also, the community can't say, let's just do it. I mean, you know what I mean? So it is where, so this is really, if you think things need to be in there for the community to see, that's one piece.
Okay.
If you think, no, that's not necessary, we just need to hear what we need to hear as a board to make a decision next week, that's yet another thing. So it's strictly up to you as to what you want to see for next week.
I got you.
Or it could just be the resolution.
Or it could just be the resolution. It's whatever you
want. I think it's important that the data be put out there and it be tweaked.
Absolutely.
So, yeah.
Okay.
Like, this is a perfect one for everyone to see.
Right. So this is the decline in enrollment based on the fall count and the funding. So the amount of students that we have lost, and then the annual funding impact, and then the cumulative funding impact, meaning that if we've lost them, then adding them up. So that's, this is the difference between the kindergartners we have for this year and the graduating seniors. So you can see the difference in the kindergartners that are in seats right this minute versus the seniors who are going to graduate, the difference in the classes. And Eric and I included this because it's something he and I have always looked at in curriculum, and we weren't sure that everyone was always looking at it, but it is certainly, we're not demographers, but it's just something to look at in terms of this many kindergartners in versus the number of seniors.
So you're saying that 88 kindergartners, and we take in other kids of school of choice, so then...
But this is all of them.
107.
It includes school of choice kids.
It includes school of choice.
So what is the all other?
So all other is all the other students we declined. The first are just, we declined by 88 kindergartners between kindergartner and seniors.
I see.
And then our total is, we're down 195 total. We just broke it down just out of our curiosity of how many seniors versus kindergartners. Because we're hoping, obviously, you'd like your kindergarten number to be the same.
And on that, to that point too, Lisa, the universities are doing the exact same thing. They're looking at what's the kindergarten coming in, what's the seniors going out, because that gives them a really good idea of what's going on for, you know, what classes they're going to have to offer.
I have to say, I've always looked
at
this number, and it hasn't always been this drastic. It has kind of fluctuated here and there, but this year it was a pretty big decline.
And the trending of this is what the board.
Well, we haven't really seen a trend. That's kind of the nutsy part. We have been kind
this
of
is where,
up and down. It could be the start of a trend. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But what come into play, because I've seen some of the data and some of the slides, is that it's not just Lawrence Creuse, but in the state of Michigan, we lost a lot of people. And then now, because families moved away, then the decline in student population in the state of Michigan, some of the data shows that it's...
And what we see in Macomb County is people stay, elderly people stay in their homes, and our number of students per household is dropping. That's the trend. That
because
the
older families.
They tend not to be mobile. So
people have two kids now where they used to have four.
Or six,
You know, four was an average number. Now you have two because they cost as much as four.
But the birth rate is declining.
Well, and that's the thing, is the demographers we had giving us information last year said this is a 15 to 20 year decline. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, the question is how bad is each year and cumulatively? But it's a 15 to 20 year decline.
Well, it is a bad winter, so.
Well, the good. There is.
No,
it's not. So, let me ask a numbers question here. You said this is the largest decline you've seen, right?
No, this isn't the largest. This is just a large decline.
Okay, so on average, less than 100 kids is our disparity. Is that correct?
I don't know what the average is for the last couple of years. This just caught my eye when I looked at it, that it was large. But we can go back and get those numbers.
Yeah, could you get the decline since 2008?
Between kindergarten and seniors.
Right,
okay.
Since 2008, because that's when the market fell, everything went in the dumper, and people started moving out.
We've actually got that somewhere. We have seen it was roughly like 185-ish a year,
yes.
Give or take.
You know what, I'd like to see it in graph form, actually.
If our disparity is between our graduating class and incoming kindergartners is 88, then where do you get the 195 student decline in student?
Those are all the other
grade levels. Right, so these are over 100 students leaving our district.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and they're leaving our district because...
Why?
Well, Eric and I did a survey with it.
Well, that's pretty old now, though.
2 years ago,
mm-hmm.
That we had done the survey, and at that time, the majority was families moved for housing opportunities or job opportunities. Mm-hmm. There was a very small percentage moving for school opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
And we sent that survey out to all of the families that we had email addresses from Empower School that had
mm-hmm.
left. But that's certainly something that we could institute again. But at that time, it did not show that they were leaving because of schools.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, that could change.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay. Next slide.
So internal school of choice. What internal school of choice is, students who are choosing a school, they live in our district, their resident school may be Atwood, but they choose to go to another school. And we've been...
So they're really not school of choice. They're just changing school. They shouldn't be... they shouldn't be considered school of choice.
Are we taking notes on this? I'm sorry.
Well, I am, and then I think we just need to talk about it.
Okay, I just
want to
make sure, we're reflecting.
Again, that doesn't have anything to do with the school choice,
yeah.
What you're asking us to
as
vote on the
recommendation. As long as they're residents of the district, and like a kid's mother once would go to Atwood, but she works like post to South, and she wants one of her kids to go to a Southern school.
Completely irrelevant.
It has, really to me, it has nothing to do with... school of choice.
I, for the purposes of voting on school of choice, Mary, I agree that this would be irrelevant. However, for our information as to what's going on in our district, I find this very relevant.
Again, that's another demographic issue. It could go to demo, absolutely. It's an outside thing, but if we're talking about schools of choice,
mm-hmm. to me, it should be part of
all right,
of
so
that
I'm trying to get a feeling from others as well. So it sounds, there's a theme of doing it, perhaps we do demographics
mm-hmm.
after fall count numbers become firm.
Exactly.
Right.
And we do a demographic update to the district, which would give separation between that, a couple months separation.
Because I like
some separation between that and school choice.
To me, it's interesting that people who live in one particular school district, say Atwood, are moving their kids to other schools.
Mm-hmm.
Like Graham is quite a ways from Atwood. And I'd be curious. Probably it's
usually job related.
Job
yeah.
related,
well,
or
I
there are
I
other children who are
that.
In the daycare and they just want to pick them all up at
right.
one time.
Until we have the surveys.
I agree. I think that this has nothing to do with what we're voting on, and I think that it's great that we've moved this over to a different presentation
mm-hmm.
based upon demographics. But I do think that this says a lot about the climate in our district. I think that there's I think it lets you know what schools are desirable and what schools are not desirable within our own
okay.
district.
And sometimes
and
it's desire and sometimes
I think
it is,
we get
it
a
is
survey,
for jobs,
I don't
too.
Know.
So
I,
we can't
I
we
would,
can't plug anything into the whys
right.
of that.
I would
right,
like
but
a survey
there's,
on
there's
justice.
Many different
yep.
reasons why these numbers reflect the way
that they
do.
And it will show you, too, we're losing a whole lot in the South and gaining a lot in the North versus, you know, maybe the opposite,
mm-hmm.
you know.
But remember, this data is... just data
yep.
until we do some sort of survey
yes.
right,
to give the whys and wherefores.
So, but I agree. I don't think it needs to be
a
part of
the workshop. This should be presented all in a workshop. And with the data that says Mrs. Smith moved her kid from Atwood to Yaks and why.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just why.
Okay. I think we're in the same boat with the next slide, school release and not schools of choice.
No. I will point out, though, that the
and I don't know, I'll be honest with you, I don't know how formally this occurred or not, but there was a decision at some point made to create the rights, go to the next slide, please. On the right side, the district guidelines, and again, this can be is totally separate, you're right. But there was a decision made at some point to allow releases on a guideline of 18 months of previous enrollment in the district.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that that's something, we don't have to address that immediately, but that's something before, if that, if there's a desire to address that issue, because that is a local control issue, as to how to address releases before next school year, that is something that we can wait on, but something that we can talk about if you do. So again, if it comes to me, we'll bring it up and talk about it. If it doesn't, assume that we would stick with the previously enrolled for 18 months on accepting releases.
This is something
releases
that we'd asked for sometime for a little while ago.
I have
to
a
get
quick
some
question
data.
And again, has
hey, Mary, let's
I'm sorry.
No, I was just saying, this part of where this came from was a request from the board for just some more detail on what this was, what was happening, what
right
were the reasonings behind it.
Okay.
Oh, that's how we got that.
Yep.
Okay.
So my quick question is are we releasing students to other districts?
We do, yes.
Why?
I guess that's a why question, too. Why are these kids going to other districts?
There are three reasons, okay? Three, the form is a standard form. I can show you what one looks like. Not at this moment, but three reasons, and the majority of them are a senior year,
yeah,
or they've never been here before. Those are
the
well into the 90% time.
And there's the vice versa. So in other
correct
words, you know, we may give some students a release, but by the same token, we might ask for release.
So,
mm-hmm,
for example, they completed 11 years of education in Anchor Bay, and they moved to a new house in Las Creuse. They want to finish their
that's
senior year. That's
typical
one of the exceptions.
I hope we're not releasing our athletes to Dakota.
Until we get an improvement in coaching staff. That's good.
Okay,
happen.
Well, okay. Hold on.
No, we don't need to release our
athletes.
Wow.
Well,
right. And
that's a
we're back. That's
how's the video? I mean, sorry.
Audio for
that's
how
the staff
oh my God,
attack.
You just got bleeped.
You got bleeped.
Go ahead.
Amy, there's some of this we're extending the discussion on inter-district, et cetera, but there are other things within school of choice that allows, if the discussion, if the board chose to go a limited school of choice, then those things do bear concern for the board because you're making a decision on the number of students that go to each building. So if we have a building that has higher, so we have the option of doing no school of choice, limited school of choice, or unlimited. If you were to go to a limited school of choice and say the number of seats at each building, then the number of seats open or how the within the district, what we do, that would be then this discussion and some of these numbers that we're talking about would be important. So we're kind of jumping ahead, I think. We're already saying we're considering, and from what the proposed unlimited, and that's fine, but I just want to be sure that if that these numbers could be important if we decided to go to a limited number of seats open, then the number of seats within the district and what we do would be a part of the discussion.
Okay. So one reason that I included this release in here is because we are limited at the high school. So Eric's example of saying we have a Lawrence Crew student who is a 12th grader and they move to Anchor Bay. We are not open for school of choice in 12th grade, so they could not apply to come back to us. But in this particular situation, we could consider a release because they've been with us and they want to stay. So that is why it is included in the school of choice, because a question has come up in the past of why would those kids just not apply for school of choice? Well, we are not open for school of choice
right
for 12th
grade.
Okay.
They're really not school of choice. Either they've been in our district.
No, it's not.
No,
it's
not.
And
that's why but there has been the question, and sometimes even teachers or staff ask, well, why don't they just apply for school of choice? Well, because we aren't open for 12th grade school of choice, but by the eyes of the law, they have moved out of our district, but we are allowed to grant a release. The law allows us to grant a release.
Okay.
So these are just the parameters for the release. These are the students that have been released. Just some data, we can certainly take that out.
So now on this, is this released
in regards to what you're saying as students coming back here, or is
correct.
This released as students that we're sending out?
Students released coming back to us.
Okay.
But this has nothing to do, again, with school of choice.
It's not on
it's
the
release.
Agenda.
Has nothing
it's not
to
on
do
the motion.
With schools of choice.
Yeah. Right.
It has
this
no...
go back to go into a data.
That goes in the demo or whatever.
Yeah.
Residential
affidavits. We include residential affidavits under school of choice because there is always confusion about residential affidavits, and so I like to talk to people about it so that they understand. If a family, for example, if I suddenly couldn't take care of my house anymore, I didn't have a home anymore, and I moved in with my brother who happens to live in Las Creuse, and we were living in the same household, I would not be applying for schools of choice. I would be a residential affidavit with him because my name would not be on the mortgage or the lease. I would not own that house here. By law, though, I have the right for my children to attend here because I am living with a resident. Residential affidavits, we have to grant those. They do become our students because they are living within our district. However, because they don't have the residency requirements, that they can't be a resident, but they also can't be schools of
however.
Choice.
Actually,
however,
in that situation, you are considered
homeless.
Homeless.
Yeah, I was just going to point
that
out. That
is
sometimes.
A homeless situation, and then you are in the district. That is not a residential affidavit. But again, residential affidavits don't have anything
right.
to do with this
okay.
presentation. And the only thing we're telling people is, we're going to do schools of choice, but here's all the other ways to get around it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
well,
it's
this
just
wasn't
showing
for other
that
people. This was for the board.
Right,
the board
yeah,
is
yeah,
going
to
do X, Y, and Z, but here's all the different ways you can get around it. And I know that. Because when people come to me and they say, my kid, blah, 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 I say, this is how you get around it. Because this is what Lions Creuse does. And they go ahead and they come into the administration building and then they give me a call and they say, oh my God, you're totally right. That's how you get around it. I know.
So the fact that you are living with a family is, you might say technically homeless because you don't own your own home. But true homeless means you have no place to stay.
No. True homeless,
no.
According to the McKinney-Vento, says that you are not living in your home.
I'm not talking that law. I'm saying in the practical reality of people's lives.
Well,
if you have no place to live, you are truly homeless. If you've got a place to stay, it's not your home.
I know.
But you are under a roof. That's all I'm saying. I get the law and I understand all that, but you know.
Yeah, in practicality, homeless to me is they're living in the car.
Well,
that's not.
The difference with residential affidavit is living with a relative. So
right.
that,
and this is true for every district, though, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes.
This is not just
residential
us. This is every district.
Some
yes.
people have combined families that, you know.
Right. Okay, so
we can take out the
so we want, where do we want this at? Anywhere?
I think this should be demographics.
Demo file.
Okay. Anyone?
Okay.
We don't need
good.
Okay.
Well, I have just a general comment. I mean,
yes.
For me, if I'm a parent out there and not knowing what school of choice is, are we starting out with just numbers?
Okay.
Or are you going to give a quick snippet about what school of choice is? Because a lot of misconceptions out there is that it's anybody in any, I mean, and I know we maybe do this every year, but we have new parents, so
mm-hmm.
I just strongly recommend that we just do a quick little snippet about what school of choice is.
So
I do too, and like
well,
the limited and
Creuse.
Then the unlimited
right.
and the, you know. The
just the fact that you have to live in Macomb County, just
yeah.
the very basic information.
Well, at this
and
point, I
points.
Have everything taken out except starting right here. So we can...
In a definition slide.
That's all. Because
that's
I know that to this
like
day,
one.
You still have parents that think that we can take any kids from any part
right.
of the United States of America
and,
or something.
And
I
would
know.
Suggest along those lines is that once we have the definition, either before or after, we talked about it in here, but I think it's good for people in the community to know what obligation the board has in terms of the school of choice. You know, we talked about that earlier, so why not put that in
the well, numbers? And also the idea that Jeff's point is right, a lot of people truly don't understand what it is, and I think that we've done a pretty decent job of explaining what it is and what it's not, but there are a lot of people that just assume you say school of choice, it means I can go anywhere I want. There's, you know, in-district school of choice, there's in-county school of choice, there's contiguous county schools of choice.
Everybody
so,
lumps it together. When
yes.
I've been going door-to-door, people are just thinking,
yep,
school of choice,
I guess
period, end. And then as soon as you talk about limited, and they didn't realize
no,
that.
So
no. I think having
and
a slide would be good.
And the time frames, too, because
yep,
one's a really tight, so they just think they can come in. I think I've actually been here when someone walked in like 2 days after school started and assumed they could just get in.
And it's only at the semester break, right?
Terry, could you just expand on when you say what the board's obligation is?
Well, when we were talking about, and I think you clarified something that Mary said about that annually we have to consider school of choice. So I'm just saying that whatever it is that's in our policy related to that, let's just make our people in the community aware of what we're supposed to do.
Okay.
And the true definition of school of choice, because
you can say the legal definition.
Because changing schools. That's school of choice, really. Teachers bringing in their own children that they live out of the district. Well, that's part of their contract and their, you know, it's not like somebody out in East Detroit who doesn't work in the district brings their kid up here. To me, that's school of choice.
If it is a part of their contract, it is a little bit of a different thing. Oh, it's not part of the contract?
It's not, but it's a courtesy, right, that we do for our teachers.
School of choice.
Yeah,
so they have to apply the same way other people do for school of choice.
I don't know.
So their child can be refused the same as any other school of choice.
I don't know about that.
I don't believe we have to make the same application on this. It's district policy.
They don't automatically get in because they're teachers, but we do.
It's actually in our board policy that if you are an employee in the district, your student, your child may attend school.
I mean, technically, I don't think it has to be part of our application to the state to go for school of choice.
So then are they an exception to the rule of school of choice?
Mm-hmm.
So should they be counted in as children for school of choice?
I believe I have those in one of the slides removed.
Mm-hmm. My thinking is if we're limited school of choice, and I'm not in favor of school of choice, but that's my personal opinion, but if we have limited numbers for students to go to high school, and a teacher starts here, and her child is going to start high school, and they want their child in our district, they're an automatic in.
Right, and we don't count that in the
So they shouldn't be counted as school, in the numbers, so that if we allow 10,
is it in there or is it not in there?
Yeah.
Is it or in there?
We do not take away a seat for them. If we had 20 seats open, and my son has been going all along, and he's going to come in ninth grade, we don't take away a seat for the employee's child.
Yeah.
And before we leave what should be on the slides, I think what we talked about as far as the timeline, if in fact in this district, because some districts do it once a year, some do it at the semester, whatever it is we do, I think it ought to be in there.
So this slide is included so that you could see, I believe it was Sharon that just mentioned, the districts around us and their participation in school of choice, because like several of you mentioned, it is different district to district. The ones that are highlighted in yellow are the ones that have unlimited, and they're also doing contiguous to Macomb County, and they're doing 105C.
So column one on the left side is
within the ISD,
which is what our recommendation is and what we're currently doing. Column two is, you see more no's there, that is if you accept students from other counties
from contiguous counties.
Yellow would be yes in that one, and then the right is exactly what their plan looks like, and you'll see some differences there.
So it's important to know that it's contiguous to Macomb County. So for example, Anchor Bay is not accepting students from Kent County, because that's not touching
Macomb
County.
Even no one is. Centerline isn't either person.
Did you say Kent County?
Kent, yes, because it's not
like
contiguous to
Grand Rapids?
Correct.
Yeah.
Well, because I couldn't think of a closer comment. And I know that one doesn't touch.
That is a bus ride to school.
This is our grade point average comparison that had been asked for in the past, actually I think also in another request, but of our resident students versus our school of choice students. We provide this information because sometimes there is a misconception that the students that come to us from school of choice are not at the same academic standards as our students. And as you can see, there is a tiny bit of difference, but it is definitely a tiny bit of difference. It's hovered right about the same amount year to year. So my
question on this is it pure school of choice students,
yes,
or are you mixing in the teacher students and the other ones that kind of
in district
but move different schools, or a teacher or an employee's child?
So,
or is this pure school of choice?
This is just pure school of choice. If you notice the little asterisks, so for this 16-17, 78 non-resident students, they are not included. Those are our 78 our employees or releases. They are not just school choice. So those employee students and those release students that we have kept because they have stayed with us are not included in this comparison. So it's just purely school of choice.
Okay.
Or homeless, potentially, too. Mm-hmm.
Right. Discipline, this is a question that also has been
all right,
asked.
Before we start this one has been, I can think of no more than six or seven times this one has been changed because it is, and my head is spinning about this, about an accurate way to show this, so I think it's very debatable about how you show something that's transparent with this before we start, so let's just take a look at it. Well, let's just, well, I think we have, I remember it at one point was, you had a much smaller sample size for school of choice students than you do resident students. Mm-hmm. So if you look at total amount of discipline for a smaller sample size versus a larger population, it's not a very fair comparison. So I just want to be, I understand that. And I also think that's why the percent of subgroup discipline is more interesting than the total discipline, I guess is what I'm trying to point out for that. Because I think the point of total discipline was all that had been included in the past, and that doesn't speak to the amount of discipline within a much smaller group. So that's just a math thing.
And the degree of discipline, to me, is an impact. Being tardy three times could be discipline, but it's not as important as disruptiveness.
Where you'll
infractions in the dress code is a discipline issue. Repeated infractions.
Yeah, right.
But that's
these are
not
suspensions
really
and expulsions. These are suspensions, not
just infractions.
These
not
are
infractions.
Wound up suspensions.
Yeah. These are suspensions
or expulsions.
I'm not sure that
these are the big disciplines.
Then
these
I think it should be indicated resulted in expulsion
or
suspension.
Because it's not just student discipline. It should be titled then. Expulsions and suspensions.
On a totally separate issue, are you telling me that out of our 1,400 students, almost 1,000 of them were disciplined with a suspension?
But it could be a day of ISS.
It should be what?
No.
I'm sorry?
No, you found another issue with the data, Jeff.
Yeah.
Okay. Because you look at these numbers like, oh my God, it's like
no.
Everybody, almost
like,
everybody
got
suspended.
She could have done seven of them.
It's not number of incidents.
And when we look at the student, you see that student, if we have a discipline problem, you'll see
yeah.
10,
yeah.
15, 20.
I don't think this slide ought to be used.
I wanted to ask Greg something on this. Yeah. Last time we did something with percentage of kids that receive marked discipline, what percentage of the school was receiving discipline? 15, 10? 12, something
not
like that.
Hairs, Eric. Are you talking about referrals?
I'm talking about.
When I do the quick math on that, that's five suspensions a day.
Right, that's way too many.
That's only 180 days of school.
Right.
So.
But these are multiple days for.
Are those the number of days of suspension?
It definitely counts kids more than once if they have multiple
yeah.
suspensions.
Sure.
My point is.
It does count.
My point is. This is something else we need to confirm again. But.
Well, to be
go ahead.
More to the point. Approximately, from experience, 80% of our kids have no discipline.
None, right, 80%.
Have none.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Eric's beginning introduction, I'm like, okay, we have this whole presentation that's been developed through the years.
Yes.
I'm not in love with it, but I'm looking to board leadership on this. I think as a board, we need to look at how we got to where we are today. Much of this was developed because we were trying to inform the community, and Lisa mentioned it, how do you inform the community of what it is, what it isn't, why we do it, what the justifications, what the positive and negatives are. Much of this presentation was developed to answer community questions because they were brought into the discussion.
Okay.
They were invited into the discussion, and their impact was part of the discussion at the meetings. That's how we got to where we are. If this board, and Eric's asked, this board, is this the route we want to go? And it's seemingly saying, we just want direct information about school of choice and clarify it. Now, if we choose to do that, and I think it's constructive, you know, don't do remember that sometimes the community has these questions. I think Jeff mentioned that too. How do you explain, how do you educate the community on what and why we do what we do? Mm-hmm. That, but seemingly, this board is saying there's two different things. So we have a decision to make based on budget, availability, staffing, and the direction of the district. But then we also have said there is a community side of this where they need to understand, you know, what it, that is part of our role too, to help the community understand why the board's doing what they're doing. But it's, I think we're getting more to like the presentation and what we're addressing is a school of choice matter. Mm-hmm. The education of the community is important, but that's a separate item.
But I think we can accomplish the same kind of thing. Because first of all, people that I have talked to are really confused about school of choice, and one of them might be because this presentation has everything but the kitchen sink. But I think if we, in an education way, had a few slides, this is what school of choice is, this is what the board's obligation towards school of choice, this is what some historical data, that one slide about what every other district in Macomb County, I think, is a key and critical. When you talk about this, you could simply have a slide to say that when school of choice applications come in, if there are expulsions or suspensions, it factors in. I mean, I think nobody in the community would argue with that. But to go into all of this, this just adds a confusing element, I think.
I think this is good for us as a board, but I agree that you'd look at, like, you'd have a reaction like Jeff, like, holy.
Well, he said a parent say it the other day. He said, we're going to be talking about open enrollment. Okay, so you're going to open enrollment now during the middle of the school season, and what are you going to get? You're going to get all the students that are bad seeds. And I'm like, no, that's not necessarily true.
No.
So I'm just saying, I just had a discussion with a parent the other day. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, we need to clarify this. And just to understand, too, this total number of discipline, school of choice, I mean, it's cumulative, right? Meaning that if you are a school of choice in middle school and now you're in the high school, I mean, it's not just the 30 high schoolers that we are allowed to have a school of choice, because you have some kids that...
Correct.
Okay.
Absolutely.
And that's why the slide is not good.
You're right.
Right.
So
because
right, you, when you say, well, there's only 30 kids, are you telling me 30 kids count 10% of the discipline?
This was meant to color perspective to make school.
I just want accurate data. That's all.
Right.
That's all. I mean,
but that begs the question, though, Mary, because if that's true, that means that we have employees who lied to put this slide together.
No, I think it's not.
If you're saying this was done to make ours better,
manipulate data however you want.
I think it
this is a manipulated slide.
No, I'm saying there. Well, we've discovered two further issues.
For sure.
Looking at it further about referrals versus discipline.
Correct.
And cumulative effect of being school of choice. So, for example, if someone has been school of choice since first grade and now they happen to be in high school and get in trouble, they come to the school of choice status. I mean, that's...
Yes.
What I would like to see in a slide like this, because your disciplines, I'm assuming, and help me understand, that 993 is the actual, is the disciplines, but it could be one student has been disciplined and suspended 5 times.
That is true.
I would like to have numbers, though. Students with 2-day disciplines, or 2 individual disciplines, or 3 individual, you know, broke down
and
by...
I think that would be in the more of a demographic.
You get some
overall, unless we change, the title and we give some more information on here, I think it's a damaging slide. And if I were to have seen this, I would have like, there's no way my kids are going to go to these high schools.
But just to
I know
that,
exactly.
There are requirements, correct, that we do that we cannot accept. Where we have discretion when accepted, and I think that the public needs to know that if we,
and that's coming,
because okay, just because of that exact reason I just talked to the parent about. So.
Yep. And another thing I would like for school of choice is, what are our requirements to we get 60 applications for school of choice and we have a limited number of students. How do you weed out and make sure that you get the 30 you want?
You can't.
So you just take
that.
The first 30
to
come in,
you
and that's it? Then that needs to be explained to the public that we don't have an option of saying we're picking the cream of the crop.
No, you can't. No,
we don't have to do schools of choice.
I know you don't.
We don't have to do it. I mean, this overriding thought process that we are obligated to it, we are not obligated to it. We could open schools of choice to 30 kids in kindergarten and be done with it. and not have to worry about all this other crap.
Can be limited.
And we could make ourselves a desirable district. But right now, we just are open to everything. Hey, come on over. We're wide open doors. I don't do this in my home.
Elementary to me, I would leave it open for
let's
elementary.
Stick with
that's but
let's go with the presentation.
Okay.
Okay. So this is our demographic comparison. Again, certainly this is something that we
I think this one's probably a no-go based
yeah,
on previous presentation.
It would definitely be demographics. This was just our percentages. Now this is what Amy was asking for earlier. And so I guess what I'm looking for here is this something that we would want to remove for schools of choice and have in demographics. These are the suspensions based on days. So a one-day suspension, a two-day suspension, and so on, all the way up to 10 or plus days. I did not include expulsions because there are very few. I mean, they all come here. You know your expulsions. I didn't include expulsions on here. We could include expulsions on here. Sometimes that's so limiting, though, that we get into kind of a gray area of the fact that if we only expelled one student in 16-17, that would be identifying, you know, and we can't identify people. But so would this be something you would want to see in schools of choice, or is this something that, I mean, would
it's
it
just
be
better. This is better than that other one.
But it's still, to me, it's not really impacting on school of choice, the explanation of school of choice of the public.
No, but it kind of leans to what Jeff is saying of, when he's talking to a parent who is saying the school of choice kids that we are accepting are have more discipline.
And just so I understand this slide, when you say schools of choice students, 413, what is this? We have 413 school of choice students in the high schools.
In our traditional high schools, yes.
Okay.
Total. And this accounts for, like what you said, students
the
who are with us first, yes.
Okay. So then, I would appreciate this slide
I
as
like
a parent.
That slide.
So include, keep this one.
Yeah, better than that. Okay.
Yep.
More informative.
Okay. Yeah, exactly. There's more breaking and stuff.
Okay, what is this?
Sorry, I pushed the wrong button. I just made it bigger for you. It was the same slide.
Okay.
This information is the school of choice students by school. So if you look, for example, Atwood, kindergarten, 11 students total in 86, and then in fall of 14, the total number of students was 685, so that was 13% school of choice. The reason that I included this slide, and we certainly can remove these, is because sometimes there's the perception that some buildings are heavy school of choice, and some are, for sure, but sometimes there's the perception that ones are that aren't, and
well,
so this just kind of lays it out.
I can attest to this because, in fact, after it happened, after I went door to door on one particular day, I stopped by and shared with Eric that in this one neighborhood, the perception was from a kindergarten teacher at one of our schools. She said that 80% of her classroom, and then it was extrapolated to mean the whole school, was school of choice. 80%. Now that particular one was Graham. Well, I see that's not the case. If we would have this data, or we could show that data, that's erroneous.
Mm-hmm.
So in fact, I said to this parent, I said, no, 80%, no, I don't believe that's true. I got the straight information from Eric and was able to share. But there's wide perceptions. People hear that it's 80% or 100% school of choice kids, and that's just not true. Mm-hmm. I think what, obviously we'd have to, 14, 15 is a long time ago, but whatever data that we have that would show the current situation, I think is important, whether we have it for our own use or we put it in the presentation.
I think it's good for those very reasons, but personally I think that the historical from 14-15 is fairly valid. It kind of shows them like a timeline or, you know, what our trend is also, but for those very reasons, this is what your truth is, not what you heard from Sally down the street.
But just this, so I understand, because
or the teacher, right,
when you
exactly.
say school of choice, this is not
inter-school
of choice.
No, this is not,
okay.
Like, I live in Atwood's area, but I go to Park and
okay.
Office, and this isn't employees.
Okay.
The reason, Sharon, that I included the multiple years is, for example, if you look at Atwood, it's relatively consistent the last couple of years, 14, 17, 19.
Mm-hmm.
And many of them are like that. Carcanore, 7%, 6%, 6%. So that's why I included the historical
trend. Oh, I like
trend.
That now. Yeah.
So because just like what Terry was saying, some people are like, well, it's 80%. Well, it's never been 80%. So, I mean.
Right. And because this parent was vocal, I can tell you from other people on the same street, that as soon as everybody heard, then now I'm going to Lutheran or I'm going to. So now you have a whole bunch of people on that street that are going to a private school. Because it worked for this one family, and it's based on erroneous information,
exactly.
So it's not good.
Yeah.
So it's three slides. It just breaks down each building for those years, and then the totals. This slide, and certainly this might be one that we want to remove. This is the gain loss report by county. This is information that you can get off My School Data. I believe at one point, and I'm not sure, it might have been a discussion I had with Don a while ago, or maybe we talked about it at an open board meeting, was students that come to us from other counties versus students that leave us to go to other counties. And the reason
districts.
That this is...
Districts.
Sorry.
Yeah.
No, this is county. This is actually by county, which is not always by district.
But we don't accept kids from other counties.
We don't. But they move, they leave. You can find this information. This is not school of choice information. This is information that people ask, where do our students go? So this would definitely be one, I think, for demographics, not for
right,
school of choice.
Right, because this would be confusing.
Yep.
People would
yeah.
just figure
this
that
they
go. We do take
this is
program.
Where they move
or
to.
Or now we lose 1,022
from.
Students.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Well, and the one that I just kind of wanted to point out on that was it seems odd, like why do we have, you know, St. Clair County or Wayne County, some of these are also virtual schools.
Oh yeah.
This is the gain loss report for districts in Macomb County, and I think this would probably be also more of a demographic, not school of choice, because this is not necessarily just school of choice.
Yes.
There are people that are okay. All right, so here's the meat and the
yeah.
timeline. These are the open seats that we are recommending. Unlimited schools of choice for kindergarten and grade 8. Kindergarten through grade 8, sorry, not just kindergarten and grade 8. Kindergarten through grade 8. The change here is the timeline.
Yeah, that's good. Keep going.
Okay. Limited school of choice, grades 9 and 10. This is the same as it was, 20 seats total. Then the MST program, the grades 10 and 11 seats, and the timeline. If you notice, the programs that are limited, the 9th and 10th and the 10th and 11th, that is, we can only have a 30-day window on limited.
Okay.
I'm sorry, but the slide before that, I have a question about it.
Yes.
No, it's not that one. I'm talking about this one.
So I'm sorry, I cannot see that.
Game loss report.
This one.
That districts,
one.
Yes. Districts.
That
part.
One. So you
these
said,
are districts.
Mm-hmm. So you're saying 130 Lance Creuse students from Chippewa are coming to us,
mm-hmm.
and 167 of our Lance Creuse kids are going to Chippewa.
Correct.
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And then, like, for example, East Detroit, you're saying 42 kids we're getting from East Detroit schools,
mm-hmm.
and 3 of our kids are going to East Detroit.
Correct.
That's what that says, yes.
This is what this
okay.
says. And this is all from
sure.
My School Data.
Yeah.
This is
yeah,
our,
it's public. Anybody
yep.
can get it. Okay. Thank you.
Yep. Okay. So these are the suggestions, the recommendations for our offering.
So back to the original sheet, the original sort of sheet that people are talking about is the rules sheet or the way school of choice worksheet. I don't know how else to describe it, but the rules on this are that if you have a limited if you're limited in any of your offering and your recommendation, you have a 1 month window.
Yeah.
So that's something else to pick up on some of the comments that's embedded within this, but that rule exists for if you have a limited window.
What do you mean by the limited?
Okay, so if you choose to make a recommendation on a portion of all or a portion of the student body for your recommendation.
To take up the extra seats.
To take the seats, and you're saying it's limited, meaning we're going to take this many seats, not unlimited, then you have a 1 month timeframe to accept those. It could be a different month in May, but you have to choose a month to do that. And it's unlimited, and when it's unlimited, that is not
on. And advertise it.
That's correct. And so I'm just telling you that's the background of, there's a legal background on that particular piece, but go ahead.
Isn't our 20 seats total both high schools, or is it?
It's total.
Okay.
It's total.
So
it's 10.
No, what I'm saying is,
about 10.
You could read this and see grades 9 and 10, 20 seats total, and think it just means grades 9 and 10, not 9 and 10 both schools. Do you know what I'm saying?
I think so.
And the recommendation had something
total.
About 11th.
Right, but like I said, I know what it is, but if I were just looking at this, I would think it just is 9 and 10. I wouldn't consider that it means...
Four district or something.
So it should be... not 20 seats...
District-wide.
Yes.
And for information, be careful, the program seats, what was discovered in the last couple of years is that you are allowed to apply to the state for program seats, so they are program specific. Getting to what Amy's comment was before about who is accepted versus who is not,
mm-hmm.
If you have programs, and I know this could take us in a different direction here, but if you have programs that have admission criteria, and we can publish what those are, any programs that have admission criteria, you can have a limited school of choice for those particular seats. So in other words, if you...
The ROTC program, for example.
You could.
I was in culinary arts.
You could, and the way we've handled it through those has been through consortium agreements the 8 or 9 districts. But you could... The issue with partial day programs versus a full day program is that you are then taking them for the rest of the day, no matter what. So again, and you have to apply the same criterion to our own kids. So do we have a criterion to let kids into culinary 1?